Hello. So my name is Paloma Gonzalez. I'm a second year PhD in computation. I welcome you all to the first lecture of the computation lecture series of the fall 2016, The Rules of the Game, organized by me, Professor Terry Knight. And this lecture is funded by Misty Chile. So I have the honor to introduce Rodrigo Perez de Arce, our first lecturer. Rodrigo is an Architectural Association diploma and PhD from the University of Caracas, has taught at the Architectural Association, the University of Bath, UPenn, Cornell, and the GSD. Currently, Rodrigo teaches at the Catholic University of Chile, and he investigates the historical landscape, programming, and dimensions of public space. He has designed major Chilean projects in Santiago, Valparaíso, the desert in the north of Chile, and have done many experimental projects there. Rodrigo is one of the best professors that I have ever had in my career.
Can you hear? Is it? Is it connected? Yes. Thank you very much. Paloma. It's a wonderful introduction of what best could one hope to hear from an ex-student. I want to thank the school, to you, and the school also for having me here, sharing these thoughts about the issue of play with the public. So the lecture is called Imprints of Leisure. I will start making a brief summary about the issue of play, or the way I see the issue of play, rather, which is some kind of parenthesis or some kind of relationship with what we could call, inverted commas, ordinary reality, as a kind of a mirror of life. So there is life, inverted commas, serious life, but there is play, which is a kind of suspension of life, and it makes a comment on life. Its artifacts, grounds, boards, implements touch upon issues of planning, urbanism, architecture, landscape, and design. In short, the subject of play cuts across disciplines, and that's something which I find very attractive. This vast universe splits in two. For play, contains a spontaneous and structured impulse, whereas game represents a ludic proposition based on rules. So there is play and game. Play and game share somewhat porous boundaries, yet the split becomes significant in its architectural projections. Whilst rule games engender interesting abstract arenas, no such formal clues could be derived from free play. Its formal materialization was unique to the modern period, however. So a unique trait of the modern period is this idea of trying to shape unstructured play and to provide unstructured play with formal arenas. The playground is modern. We will review first the notion of imprint as related to issues of inscription, framing, and design. We will then proceed to look into internal rules that inform the playground, that is to say, to the formal instructions issued from within each game that result in particular formal systems. So we'll start with the business of imprint. What you see on the screen is an exercise we did with first-year students at school in Santiago, one-to-one tracings of canonic buildings. You can see the Unité, Santa Maria de la Salute, Saint-Chapelle, and a few other buildings there. Ichnos is the impression of the scale of a foot on the terrain. The plan is also the prevailing representation of cities and territories. Moreover, play arenas often denote territorial demarcations. So in talking about imprints, we allude to that mark left primarily on the ground, in this case as an effect of ludic activity. So here we have the architectural plan, and here we have the ludic plan, which has also got a set of inscriptions, which of course acquire a symbolic value, and which are only relevant only for the purpose of a game, otherwise they have no relevance whatsoever. And here we have desktops, which is nice to see the notion of the imprint as well as a kind of a trace from which one can derive the type of activity that goes behind it. On the left is a desk for primary school children somewhere in Chile, and on the right is a desk for a studio program at MIT. Straight lines versus kind of random configurations. This ancient Greek clay figure represents people engaged in a board game. They are intensely focused, as each move might determine the outcome of the ludic riddle. It gathers fundamental elements about play: geometry, a circle, a median line, a wholly arbitrary construct, the set, a series of equally arbitrary pieces, the rules of the game, and also the players. But it's interesting also because one can see that people gather around the board, and there is that would be a kind of primary architectural consideration, understanding the board as a focus. Play forms participate of the creation of a space apart, that is to say, a bounded space and a bounded time where another form of reality prevails. Johann Huizinga linked it to sacred space, to the temenos, the Greek temenos. You step in the field and you behave as a player, and you step out and you behave as someone who's going about his or her businesses. The field, therefore, has got the demarcation, has got something of a symbolic value. But there is here is the paradox. Whereas the practices we associate with free play do not issue formal mandates for the creation of their playgrounds, the practices of structured play, otherwise defined as game, establish such strict norms for the playground, such as to banish design improvement. So one might ask, what is the role of the architect in all this? Does he or she abstain from designing for the erratic and spontaneous outburst of free play? Is the architect impotent when game fields become formulas or even better templates? Ludus. We will first look at structured play. The French sociologist Roger Caillois denominated it ludus, borrowing from a Latin term which is at the root of the ludic. A game unfolds over a predefined field. Canonic form, a standard, which is to say something generic. This must be so for games to proceed regardless of location or circumstance as games disseminated worldwide. This is a plan of the dissemination of sports in Latin America or between the Americas, and also by, as influenced by the British, the way sport games enter this continent from usually the ports, then moving inland, and then eventually becoming like a passion as we see in Brazil or Argentina. In this wonderful floating football pitch in Koh Phangan, Thailand, there is much ingenuity in devising the support, yet no invention is required to formalize the field. So here we have a first trait about formal game. The field is given. There is nothing one can do as a designer about it. The support for the field is not given. Therefore, the designer is busy orchestrating the floating structure in this case, and also situating the field in relation to a particular condition, in this case, the condition of the sea, vis-a-vis the coast, the village, and all that. In it, there is no room for design, but fields also become stages, a centripetal attractor surges from the public, wanting to follow the action. Here, there is a design opportunity, which is around the field in relation to the action, accommodating the spectators. Eventually, the centrifugal interface between play and inverted commas ordinary life becomes equally significant as the surrounding areas demand attention, calling for interplay. What architects do when confronted with rule games? They can just operate the interplay between the given, the field, a generic formula, and its surroundings. They might inscribe the field on site according to a particular agenda, and perhaps frame it with the mediating elements that will relate play to what we would call the domain of ordinary life. So here we have, this is 19th century. We saw the diagram about the dissemination of sports that come through the kind of European colonies into places like Chile, for example. and a first tentative emplacement of the field in this northern Chilean town, which is right outside the heart of the town. And here, years later, 20th century, we have Le Corbusier reorchestrating, in a way, the structure of symbolic structure of Buenos Aires, locating this kind of business center as a head, which is advancing over the coast, and locating quite significantly the stadium also in a very prominent position. So the inscription of the stadium in the hands of Le Corbusier results in giving the stadium a very, very prominent function and emplacement. There is a geographer, which is called George Bale, who has studied the way in which playgrounds evolved, particularly in Britain. And he has reached this conclusion. This is the diagram. First, there is an unstructured game. This is pre-19th century. People play a ball somewhere in the country. No precise boundaries, no precise teams, no precise rules, no precise time. Then there is a first activity of enclosure, a demarcation of a formal piece of ground as different to the rest of the area. Then the partitioning of this area for spectators. The game begins to become also business. And finally, the enclosure. And what we see up here is a painting by Lowry, English painter, who depicts the kind of slightly messy and accretional stadium that the English used to build, exactly the way Bale describes it, bit by bit. But here we have two European architects responding to the same challenge. So they cannot do anything about defining the field, which is, of course, as we've seen, is something which is predetermined. But they can do everything about establishing the kind of interplay between the field and the rest of the world. In designing the tribunes and designing the way in which this relates to the surroundings. This is the way that someone like Neufert in a manual would describe the process or the opportunities for the activity of the architect in relation to the field. So this is all framing. But here we have an amazing insight from Le Corbusier. This is around 1930s. A different idea about framing, because he brings the field right into the heart of the city. You can see how in the diagram, this is Place de la Concorde, and this is Place Vendôme, Paris. So you see how the field is elevated to the status of a prime space in the city. The field and the square are brought into a conversation, to a dialogue, which is very direct and very prominent. And instead of framing the field with seats for spectators, he's framing the field with apartments for people to live in. Such as to create an expanded field of convergence, which of course he elaborates in Virgadiers, exactly doing that is to say, placing tennis or football, which were the modern movement preferred sports, within the ensemble and surrounded by the apartments. And also, of course, playing up with the rooftops, which also become ludic spaces and so on. But here we have another operation, which I think, in my view, is not so intensely researched, but seems to be extremely interesting, which is what Louis Kahn manages to convey in one of his exercises for the definition of the government center in Banglanagar, Dhaka. When he situates the stadium across a green field of grass from Parliament, and in doing so, he's kind of establishing a very direct, actual, but also symbolic report between two agonistic institutions, agonistic in the sense that parliament and the stadium and sports are related to principle of competition. There's competition in parliament or in democracy as there is competition on the field. So first thing is that he actually, if one looks at Le Corbusier, for example, this is much stronger because there are just two elements that construct the symbolic center of the state here. One is built around the stadium, and it's very, very interesting what he proposes to place around the stadium. That is to say, the kind of interface that he establishes with the grounds around, with, he talks about swimming pools, he talks about art schools, and so on and so forth. But it's also very interesting that if one looks at the picture closely, access to the field itself is given through these four corners. So the field is, again, like a square. This is one step ahead of Le Corbusier. And it's much more like what he did when he was drawing the Piazza del Campo in Siena, where effectively the square unfolds also like as a ludic space. As we know, they perform the horse race once every year in Piazza del Campo, and the square becomes an arena. In a sense, what Kahn is doing in Dhaka is a similar figure. But there are certain other characteristics which would be interesting to explore. As we see, the field itself is a figure, is more like a formula in a sense that cannot be tampered with, but we can operate as designers with what happens around it and with its mode of inscription, its contextualizing and so on. Etymology confirms the notion of the generic. For the Greek word for stadium stands for measurement. The stadium is at the same time a place for games, but it's also a unit of measure. In this case, for race, there were no competitive games in Greece. And although the measures actually varied between Olympia, Delphi, Epidaurus, Corinth, or Nemea, slightly, the notion was there that the stadium was something which was inviolable, was something you couldn't tamper with. So the degree of freedom you have with this proposition is emplacement, as we see it in the picture, and working out on the interfaces between the stadium and the surroundings. Such integration, because this was a fully integrated space, such integration with the landscape was praised by landscape architect Geoffrey Jellicoe, who drew a parallel with Hampstead Hill, London, where the field abuts the hill, just like Olympia and the Kronos Hill. So here we have Jellicoe picturing our Hampstead Hill and comparing it with Olympia, with this notion that the place, the ludic space, is something which is integrated to the landscape. And this was a matter of debate amongst modern architects, because on the whole, Greek models furnish integrated arenas. First, there was the track, then there was a mound for spectators, and that mound becomes, in some cases, much more formalized. But the place is never immersed in itself. It's always looking at the mountains and looking at the surroundings. There was a matter of debate because the Roman model appeared to be a self-immersed model, which many people decried, like, for example, Le Corbusier makes a point about how the Greeks know how to construct something which is part of life, and how the Romans somehow can ideate these wonderful buildings, but somehow completely cut off the activity from the surroundings. We can find a similar process of enclosure in different types of ludic activities. If we look, for example, at waterborne games, and we start with this figure, wonderful figure by Ozenfant, we find around the 30s, swimming pools with spectators usually in the perimeter, and we find lots of swimming stadia, so the swimming pool somehow has become cut off from the surroundings and has engendered a self-contained place. We also find this kind of very intense theaters of internal activity with spectators cheering up the children swimming on the pools as in Peckham or in this extraordinary housing scheme by Henri Sauvage in Paris. And of course, if we move forward in time, we find other types of contraptions that capture the activity and in a way seclude the activity from the outside. So there is an issue about this interface between the ludic activity and the world around it. We also find wonderful ideas about play if we look at the Piazza Navona, for example, as a square that inherits the format from a Roman race course, and replacing the seats with apartments and houses and churches. But then also, until the 19th century, every year, by flooding the square with water, the Romans recapture that ludic essence of Piazza Navona. It becomes now a water space, just for time in the summer. We're going to look now at the way in which arenas were formed and this relationship between the arena and the city and the relationship in the arena and the square. And the activity I have chosen to explore is the bullfights. And I have to make a comment that I'm not making an ethical kind of discussion about this subject, which nowadays is a very hot discussion even in Spain. But I'm rather looking at it as a historical phenomenon of a culture that considered this to be a game, a feast, even more so than a game, a feast, which was first played in places like the one Goya depicts in the outskirts, but then it's brought right into the middle of the town to be played in the Plaza Mayor. That is to say, right at the heart of the town, the most significant center, the absolute formal space of recognition of the community. There is where bullfights are staged, like also other theatrical ceremonies, like this tribunal from the Inquisition that we see in the image. So it comes in from the rural background, is brought in into the heart of the city, into the Plaza Mayor, to then and one finds also different wonderful attempts to adjust the geometries of the square and to make room for the public with this kind of makeshift constructions, which are placed for the event and then taken away, together with the sand, which is also strewn over the floor. In places like Chinchon, for example, in Castilla, where the houses have these balconies, and the balconies are traded as prime localities during the game. And there is an impromptu construction that adjusts the form of the square to the form of the arena. Or this image, which I find very significant because this is a little bit like a Le Corbusier's diagram of the football pitch in the middle of a residential enclave. This is the notion of constructing a residential enclave as a frame for the bullfights. Houses framing the bullfight, not spectator stands, houses, ordinary houses. So in a sense, what they're doing, what they're saying, is that they're making a square that becomes also a ludic arena. And eventually, we get the canonic kind of format, the circle, which now appears to be very obvious to us for such an erratic kind of trial as a bullfight. But it took a long time for this notion to be recognized by the Spaniards. And at this point, Plaza de Toros, which means Bullfight Square is built as an autonomous building which is withdrawn from the heart of town and is brought out to the outskirts. So if we look at the evolution, just like in Bale's case, he was looking at the football pitch in England. Here we're looking at the Plaza de Toros in Spain, and you find the random form, the main square, the adjustment of the square, different tries to shape this figure until arriving to a canonic figure which seems difficult to surpass. But the same happens in Rome, and it's very interesting because Vitruvius talks about that. He talks about the Forum as a place, as an arena, as a ludic arena, and he talks about the interest, the desirability of having colonnades around the Forum in order to accommodate the public to look at these proceedings of fights. And more recent archaeological digs have actually demonstrated that there were wooden constructions that link the buildings in the Roman Forum, as you see in this case. There are two kind of different hypotheses as how these constructions were arranged, and that somehow formalize, frame the arena in the middle of the public square. So here we have a case of an imprint that disappears. There is no, obviously, nothing remains of the event once they remove all this paraphernalia, unlike the modern period where the playground is constructed and is assigned a space and a format which is unique to its use. So if that is the situation with formal play, how about informal play, what Roger Cajuá called paideia, which is this Greek word which talks about childlike instincts. So we know that this is an unstructured activity which is constantly improvising and is closer to some idea of chaos than it is to some idea of order. And it might build up rules, but these rules might dissipate or might be reinvented in the spirit of the game. Roger Cajuá defines the as-if as the driving engine, whereas in the other case there was a rule which tells you how many spectators are there, how many members of the team, what is the gist of the game, what's the timing and all that. In this case, there is not such prescription, but there is a kind of instant agreement which is reached between the players, which is to do more with some world of the imagination, the world of as if. What happens if we now play to do such and such a thing? So that illusion, which etymologically comes from in ludere, to be in the game, an almost intractable force determines the course of the action and its impromptu rules. No formal instruction issued from such practices, which are so strongly guided by the imagination. But here, there is another interesting paradox where it was around paideia, where the contribution of architects and artists became decisive in the modern period. Put it another way, where they were prescribed from innovating in ludus, because they couldn't recreate the playground itself, here they found an unbounded scope of inventiveness. And here we have, of course, Aldo van Eyck, which becomes evident when looking at Van Eyck's, Noguchi, Kahn, Nielsen, Sorensen, and many others. From the design of implements, the modeling of public space to a full engagement with surface and topography, or else from narratives about art and experience to the complete divestment of site attributes for the sake of exploration in the hands of a landscape architect, as it happens in Sorensen's adventure playground. So here we have Noguchi, which is inventing topography as a kind of basis of the ludic space, Noguchi and Kahn exploring the same in New York. Again, a set of forms which an archaeologist of the future could confuse with ritual space or something to do with sacred kind of connotations, but which in actual fact is a playground. Pure inventiveness, or the case of people like Egon Niller or Pierre Janeret, playing up with the idea of sculpture as something to be lived in and something to be bodily explored as a tool for children games, with all the drawbacks that such proposition could have, because the same could be actually happening successfully with sculpture by Henry Moore or someone else, except that we're forbidding from using a sculpture for play. But nevertheless, there's something interesting in the fact that artists in the modern period, and again, this is completely new, it wouldn't have occurred to Michelangelo, let's say, that sculptures could be used for such purpose, but in the modern period, artists become engaged, they get engaged with the idea of the sort of relationship that sculpture and play might establish, and the way in which the engagement of the public is physical and is so much stronger through play than through sheer contemplation. And of course, in the lineage of the modern playgrounds, the notion of the adventure playground is extraordinary in two accounts. One is that it is invented by a landscape architect who invents a barren piece of ground as a playground. This is a Sorensen, Danish architect, who invents this piece of ground, which is just sheer availability, it's just sheer space, there's nothing in it. It is screened by vegetation, and there is a little workshop where tools are stored. And the notion of it is that the action of play is much more to do with building, with creating. He thought that these playgrounds would be fantastic places for, would-be architects or engineers to play. That they introduce the tools of the trade, and that they would incite children to follow up careers of that kind. And it is also interesting that at the end of World War II, people realized that children appropriated in a way, once hostilities stopped and there was peace on town and there were no more dangers of aircraft flying over the town and all that, children went out and they played with the wreckage of the town. And this was also something that many people realized created a very interesting foundation for a new notion of play, which was not to do with designing the ground, was to do with emptying out the ground and somehow guaranteeing a set of rules for children to do what they please within the space and the time of the playground. What I'm interested in is also the kind of iconography that we get out of all this, so that you get in the heart of the town now, let us recall Le Corbusier with the football pitch or the tennis ground. Now we have this funny contraption, this kind of skeletal construction of timber things placed in the middle of the housing estate. But behind all this, there is one consideration to be made, which is being made by people like Ortega, for example, or Huizinga, or Galloa himself, or some other philosophers, which is this notion of play as an area of the human imagination that furnishes models of action for, inverted commas, serious life, serious pursuits. Play forms embody formal or relational patterns. Such was the Smithson interest in street play, chance, and jazz, and Le Corbusier's intense involvement in rule systems. So when Peter Smithson talks about play Brubeck, for example, here we have an architect who talks about jazz in relation to urban design, which is a strange kind of model to follow. But what he's saying is that if we're caught on certain principles, we can improvise, we can have the advantage of improvising as we go, And yet there is some kind of melody, there is some kind of rhythm, there is some kind of significance or consistency about our creation, which is very different to the notion of Le Corbusier and Le Modular, where what you are supplied with is a system of proportional relationships related to a human body, but also related to an abstract system of rules, which, if you apply it correctly, you will achieve a harmonious bodies. Play Brubeck and the Modular, two Ludic models. In that sense, when one looks at Aldo van Eyck and his interest in the Cobra group, he's also looking at children behavior as some kind of a model for a city or a way of organizing space which is not so predetermined, which gives room for the imagination and which makes room for improvisation. So the iconography of the modern movement is full of suggestions about this relationship of play and a model for society. But also one finds that people like Jonah Friedman, for example, would have been very interested in seeing this very kind of fragile and spontaneous construction made by children around scaffolding, which in a way is a model for the Cité Spatiale of Friedman. It is a kind of an anticipation. We saw in Le Corbusier's image this notion of the arena as core, and I think one can review a certain collection of projects over a certain period of time and find how the place of the arena, the place of the ludic space, is somehow critical to emplacement of buildings, or how what kinds of relationships they establish with each other. Of course, in the unitary we have the rooftop as a ludic space, but also there was the idea of the ground as another kind of a ludic space. In the ground, there should have been swimming pools and sport fields. Up here, children were running around, and there was also a running track and a small gymnasium. If we compare that image with this other image, which is the housing estate in Copenhagen, which one can claim rightfully to be some kind of descendant of Le Corbusier's idea of the apartment block, although very much devalued, much less interesting as an architectural project. But what I find extraordinary is the contrasting kind of collision of imageries and worlds that we find with the rationale of the apartment block as a background and this kind of irrational, third world-like, spontaneous, shantytown-like foreground, which is the place of play. And so we can look at the playground as a kind of a counterpart to the architecture for life, let's say, where the playground can take extraordinary kind of liberties in terms of defining its own rules, as with topography, for example, in this case, and therefore establishes this extraordinary contrast with surroundings, but it retains the notion of it being the core, the central place of attention. The other option, of course, is to place the apartment right in front of the stadium, which is exactly what Le Corbusier did for his own apartment, recasting what he had set up as a kind of urban formula for everyone, and testing through his own life the notion of living in front of greenery and living in front of the sport place. Here we have Le Corbusier again in Paris with his apartment on the top. And here we have Marcel Breuer in Ithaca, New York State, substituting the sports arena with a children's playground. The iconography of the playground is, of course, much more interesting than the iconography of a sports arena, which tends to be dull and boring. And here we have the Smithson doing a very interesting operation of topographic manipulation, which not only substitutes the flatness of the gardens in the Villa Diaz, but also draws away the possibility of using the space for sport, which is exactly what Peter Smithson explained when he said that he made a mound so that people couldn't play football in the middle of the housing estate. So he was kicking away football players, but in a way he was at the same time inducing children to take possession of that space. And we find, like, between the generation of the heroic period of the movement and then Team 10, that there is this permanent kind of game of substituting the athlete for the child. And when we say that play furnishes models for social behavior, this is exactly what the Smithson did in the famous conference at the CM, when they're bringing the pictures of Nigel Henderson to propose a replacement of the four functions of modern architecture with these other categories, house, street, relationship. So there is, if one reviews what did modern architects do with the issue of play, one finds that certain architects tend to place the play arena in the middle of the housing estate, surrounding with greenery and all that. Others would play sport arena, but others would place the children playground instead of sport arena. But one finds also there's a lot of discussion about the function of the street, the ludic function of the street. And these are the Smithson's diagrams dealing with the patterns of street life, which they then want to recreate in the famous decks or streets in the air that they created. And the patterns they see, you can see it very clearly. Here is children, and here it says street, arena, space. The street is an arena for social intercourse. And the most vivid form of social intercourse for the Smithson is children play rather than sports. So far, we have traced the ways whereby the arenas for ludus and paideia were conceived. We will now briefly examine the internal rules that inform the ludic space. Such constructs are totally arbitrary, for they offer no usefulness beyond the ludic function. This is a characteristic of play. There is no function to play. There's no usefulness in play whatsoever. In ludic form, measure, as in the Greek stadium, configuration, materiality, and orientation are not just relevant, but indispensable. These are often finely attuned to such bodily issues as stamina and physical prowess. But there's a cultural context, however. Sport disseminates from late 19th century throughout the 20th century, but it somehow evolves hand by hand with the industrialization, the process of industrialization. And that's a reason why one can understand this figure by Kistler, which is called work and play, because the worker and the player, in a sense, belong to the same kind of mindset in his view. Of course, the player is a sport player. He's playing by the rules. And it's all to do with efficiency. You can be efficient on play as you can be efficient on work. And if one looks at the Architectural Review, 1935, for example, one finds in an argument about the functional tradition, this parity between tools and implements. And it is true that this exuberant kind of world of play has produced endless ranks of instruments, and that there is a kind of parity between one and the other, except that we could make any tool become a play instrument. We can play with any tool, but we cannot work with play instruments. So there is no movement from the ludic universe of tools, let's say, cannot possibly result in useful things, whereas the useful universe of tools can easily result in fun-making ludic instruments. So there is an issue about scale. If one talks about the playground, there are several issues I want to review very briefly, some of the most interesting ones. Board, table, and field suggest almost infinite gradations in scale, yet they hold in common the notion of space apart required for structured games. Notwithstanding that common ground, there are significant qualities attached to each. Firstly, epistemological and experiential frontiers distinguish objects, fields, and geographic events, for space is not a continuum, but rather a concatenation of conditions. Secondly, certain formats are embedded between ranges of scale. The graspable board, to start, in its association with the hands, but also the field in its relation to bodies in action. Formats clash against certain dimensional thresholds. Thus, for example, fields become impractical beyond certain dimensions where tracks are conceptually unlimited. So you can increase the size of a field by that much, but up to a certain size onwards, all you can do is to create tracks. And tracks can be as long as the Tour de France, for example, or Dakar Rally, conceptually unlimited. Of course, they can fold organizing rings, as in this case. Critical thresholds in scale determine the substitution of board for field games. The same holds true for the substitution of field by track games with concomitant replacements of surface for lines, complex motions for single directions, converging lines of sight for single ones. Scale in fields is loaded with specificity. So tracks become the only tenable ludic arena beyond a certain scale. And of course, there is a question as to where they are for people running, or where you use horses or mechanical equipment to organize the particular form of play. The layouts are specific. As we all know, there is something parametric about the creation of the field. There are physical forces to do with, for example, negotiating a bent, also with the difficulty that a game should set to the player. And therefore, the formalization follows a very complex set of conditions, which are internal to the game, not so much concerned with design preference, but rather concerned with what the game requires for it to retain the interest. There are issues of topology. The esplanade, the track, the discontinuous field, and recurrent topologies. The former comprises a great variety of kinds. Besides size and layout, this may beckon different surfaces such as ice, grass, or hard paving, following ludic requirements. Defined by course rather than the surface, tracks describe vectorial patterns. Although layouts may vary considerably from geometric to arabesques, from line to circuits, a golf course and a toboggan equally belong to this family, and also the maze, except that in it, the course splits into alternative paths and dead ends. Tracks can be assembled in networks, as with the French hunting rides, or they might assume complex three-dimensional configurations, as with roller coasters. Topography. The terrace level field predominates. Its optimal viewing scope turns into the ultimate stage, thus epitomizing the nexus between play and spectacle. Horizontality enhances the element of chance and guarantees equal playing conditions. Often laconic in expression, mainly through prescriptions, it might well conceal heterogeneous conditions that charge each area with specific ludic values. As we know, this laconic and kind of boring geometry conceals internal structures that assign particular values to each part of the field. In simulating agile tempos and homologating field conditions, the horizontal surface seems obvious, but insatiable ludic instinct equally values the accidents. All play rules are arbitrary, but just a few result in specific topographic devices. The hazard, says the dictionary, is a thing likely to cause injuries. Its secondary meaning, attributed to golf, being an obstacle, such as a bunker, a sandpit, etc., it might be construed in various manners, through topographic manipulation, by means of a built impediment, or recurring to any other contrivance up to the purpose of adding difficulty to the motion. So the hazard is a ludic invention, of course. It's freely chosen for the sake of fun, for the sake of making, of creating an impediment and somehow posing a challenge. Gravitational fields construe a concatenation of hazards or elements of resistance, a rock field, an unstable ground, a vertical outcrop to be conquered. The inverse of climbing . So here we have hazards. You can say that the field itself is a hazard in this type of rock climbing. There's nothing in it which is talks about excluding difficulty. Everything about it is about extreme difficulty. But sliding is also playing with gravitational fields and with topography, except that in exactly the inverse way. And so we can look at a mountain, for example, and we can compare the way in which a player scans the mountain for opportunities. If you're into climbing, you're probably more interested in the rocky outcrops. If you're into skiing, you're probably more interested in discovering possible fields. And if you're into painting or into contemplating, you have, of course, a completely different figure of what the mountain is all about. So, what this means, in my view, is that the field is a challenge to the player. That's the kind of essential, fundamental kind of condition of the field to the player. In the ludic mind, the field is a challenge. Whereas the field might be a challenge of different kind for a painter, who's not engaging physically with it, is engaging in a different kind of construct with it. But we have also, we had topography, topology, scale, the notion of the hazard as ludic kind of elements which result in certain formal configurations, but we have also orientation. This is the diagram which recommends the preferred orientation for football pitch, and this is a German diagram for a football pitch, which can be rotated at 9 angles so that grass does not get so damaged in the action. This is less serious than this one, but this is very serious because it embodies a practical perspective which relates the solar path so that it guarantees equality among the contenders. And when you have an agonistic game, you must ensure that there is perfect equality between the contenders, otherwise there's no proper game. For in setting the field along a north-south axis, excessive glare is averted, but there is also a conceptual perspective about orientation, which considers orientation in itself as a ludic challenge. Let's look first at this practical consideration. Setting the field's orientation and the alternation of players were essential to the passage from casual pastimes into sport. So the construction of sport, which is a 19th century construction, which is made mainly through the English, who are the people who are more kind of prolific in terms of establishing rules and formatting these unstructured games into something that accords to stable rules, goes hand in hand with the delineation of the conditions for the game and the formalizing of the parameters for the description of the arena. The ensuing urban results were noteworthy, as if trapped within the magnetic range, playing fields aligned with the compass. Cosmic and meteorological criteria converge with practical stewardship. A comparison of London survey of the Great Fire, 1666, and Le Corbusier, 1956, plan for the city of Meaux in France, reveals deliberate patterns of alignment. In London, orientation literally signified first in the Orient. You can see the chapels set in an east to west course because the altar was supposed to be facing the Orient, sunrise, the Holy Lands. This regular pattern of chapels, hitherto embedded, was made visible once the fire released the masonry structures from the haphazard mass of urban matter. Had the London churches been on open fields, this would have looked not unlike early modern housing blocks. They alone carried a superior principle of order. This superior order was embedded in Corbusier's lyrical vision of buildings following the course of the sun. So here we have the north, buildings set up on a north-south axis, and playing fields set up equally in the same axis. In no time, sport fields and housing blocks aligned with the path of the sun, while this held fields and urban plans correlated. His orientation, Corbusier's orientation, was equally ruled by cosmic criteria and by a desire of intelligibility. So there's orientation in terms of setting up all the elements in some relationship to the cosmic event of the movement of the sun, but it's also orientation in the sense of doing away with the clutter of the medieval city and making the city readable. If orientation fixed thus the alignment of sport fields, this orientation also became a tenable Ludic principle. In Ludic terms, it plays with the loss of sight or balance. It is a way of releasing ludic potentials out of outworn routines. To this purpose, it can follow diverse strategies. One can lose one's bearings in the thicket of a forest. One can alternatively envision a matrix of visually unintelligible paths, as with the labyrinth, or one can technically induce dense fog until occluding vision. One can induce pitch darkness for ludic purposes, or one can stimulate disorientation through vertiginous movements. One can also tamper with people's sight through blindfolding. Such as is the hazardous field of the forest hunting ground, even so in a stylized French configuration. The hunt could also be considered to have been a ludic event. We know about the royal forest, and we know that this was an event, an aristocratic event, but it is extraordinary that to think of the French forest, the hunting forest, as seen in this diagram here, as a construct, which is actually the construction of a ludic arena. And the matrix for it is quite extraordinary. And as we know, if one thinks of play as a template for, as a model for social behavior, or play as a former model for urban plans, one can rightfully say that here is the clue for the transformation of Paris in the hands of Baron de Haussmann. The French hunting forest has got the structure of the Parisian boulevards. And what the French hunting forest is trying to do is to retain the sense of disorientation of the forest, but at the same time, tries to enable the hands to proceed through these rectilinear paths, changing course as many times as necessary in order to hunt the prey. So there is a construction of a visual field, but at the same time, it's a complex visual field that does not enable you to have a command over the field. Disorientation turns the ordinary hazards, and hazards, as we have seen, easily accommodate the conceptual fabric of play. Too far removed from the certainties of a rational order, the ludic principle of disorientation rarely made it into mainstream ludic agendas. It surely conspired against intelligibility, a prized asset on the rational minds. Aside from the situationists who despise rational thought, and the captains of the leisure industry, we think of the fairground, for example, who saw in it a powerful lure for profit, it gained no relevant ascendancy in the conception of the new site for play. The deadly effects of Cartesian urban compounds prompted Aldo van Eyck, however, to elaborate upon the paradoxical notion of labyrinthine clarity, a condition that without relinquishing modern rational aspirations made room for accrued complexity and even a measure of disorder. In his mind, the figure of the athlete, formerly so pregnant, gave way to the ludic horizons of childhood. But it was only with constant knowing who is when labyrinths were assumed as urban models. Labyrinths encapsulate both a field and a riddle. They construe topological challenges. The courses must be conceived such as to blur, at any event, the intelligibility of the field. Horizons must be occluded. Likewise, lateral boundaries must reach monotonous uniformity, thus precluding any sense of progress. Original layouts challenge the player anew. Labyrinthine paths banish any depth of field for one place in them primarily against the field. The horizontal plane that obviates topographic accident offers the best conditions. Nevertheless, in New Babylon, what we have is the so-called mechanical labyrinth, which is three-dimensional, it's not horizontal. But the most important thing about New Babylon is that the city itself is understood as a ludic space, and this urban ludic mechanism is conceived as a mechanism that disorientates, that is to say, it's the reality of game is somewhat more chaotic, as we see in this other depiction. And this is quite typical of pre-industrial games, and is closer to the idea of the carnival, maybe, or the kind of activity which is boisterous and noisy and slightly disorganized. And it stands somewhere between the notion of ludus and the notion of paideia. But the important thing about symmetry is that it becomes a ludic principle, that it can be put into action in different ways. It governs all sorts of contests between two opposing factions, as in chess, for example, but also in football or in tennis. And it models many types of fields. In the same way that it furnishes the secrets or the key to the organization of the House of Commons in England, for example, where you have the notion of government and opposition as two camps divided by a central area to which the speakers accede in order to make their points. And this is in itself very similar to the structure of fields such as Montalban ball courts,
which is also kind of constructed on the basis of a symmetrical kind of arrangement. And it would be interesting, we don't have time to do that now, but the symmetry in the field makes noise in terms of the modern conception of the garden, because it runs against the notion of fluid space that modern architects were trying to set up. Here we have an academic landscape designer, forestier, trying to fit in the field, the playing field within the park. We look now at the one other aspect of play, which I think is worth discussing in certain detail, which is to do with adaptation. Bale observed how, in the course of time, fields follow alternating waves, what he calls waves of confinement and spatial release. We saw the Greek model, which was an integrated landscape model against the Roman model, which was a kind of self-immersed ball. Equally, in certain games, as in tennis, for example, there is a indoor tennis, which then moves outdoor into court, and then the court is taken out into the garden. And most games have followed these patterns from the indoor into the outdoor and back to the indoor and so on. Also from city, from country to city, usually. But also play has often followed colonial ventures, thus encountering unprecedented ecologies, costumes, and landscapes. Moreover, fields, especially cultivated ones, were often required to retain original traits, facing thus unprecedented challenges away from their habitat. So we're concerned here with spatial and architectural mechanisms that smooth the encounter between a given form of play and a sometimes difficult, strange, or even downright adverse scenario. From an architectural perspective, adaptation represents the transformation of that scenario into an arena. This, of course, depends on the game. So for example, tennis admits different ground conditions, and because the players change sides, it was possible to invent a tennis court which was made of clay and grass, whereas other games do not admit such latitudes. You cannot play with ground conditions in the same way in a football pitch. We saw the French hand in the forest, but when the hand is becomes fashionable in Britain, in the absence of forests, they have to invent, and in the absence also of big game, because they chase small animals, they have to invent a different game altogether, though they retain certain elements about the original, like, you know, the number of people who play, chasing on horse, the hounds, the attire, the kind of colorful thing that surrounds the game, but they play on the open field. They take possession of the English countryside, and they literally tramp over everyone else's fields in order to pursue the game, whereas the French would fabricate a forest next to the chateau in order to be able to pursue the game. Here we have a kind of different type of adaptation. This is in Aranjuez, it's near Madrid in Spain. There's a royal palace. In the absence of the forest, what they do in order to make something like a chase, they construct this very abstract field made of canvas with the ladies of the court sitting on this stage here, as people chase the stacks to hand them at the end of a chase. So this almost ventures into landscape art, into a form of intervention to a landscape in order to make the field becomes much more abstract and so on, but it is a form of adaptation. But one can say that to each game that is placed on nature, there is a counter proposal to be played on an artificial space. So this kind of mirror condition of play also applies to the mirroring of the natural conditions in terms of man-made conditions, which sometimes are extraordinary. One can also look at an empirical order of adaptations that concur in solving the vexing problem of how to circumvent hostile climates. For example, ski Dubai, where they want to create a skiing field within a very, very hot climate, furnished with illusionistic ambiences within, in contrast with exteriors which are clearly bereft of civic aspirations. This is looked as some kind of contraption that guarantees temperature and topography and some of the conditions, but which is not particularly interesting in conveying to the world what is going on inside or any particular meaning about what the ludic activity is all about. But if we look at the golf course, we find a much more interesting figure in terms of adaptation, because this sport is unique in begetting landscapes in the large scale. A large course is about 60 hectares. In golf, one plays with the land, for the game demands an acute tactical awareness as to the particulars of the terrain. It is also special in embracing the aesthetic of the picturesque, an aesthetic of accidents instead of norms. So here we have a game which is a rule game, but which nurtures from the aesthetic of the picturesque and which nurtures in a sense from the notion of the hazard. And as we know, the course is made of fairways, and fairways are never exactly the same, but they obey certain rules and they have certain dimensional characteristics and there are certain material characteristics allied to them. And this gives golf a very, very kind of flexible kind of plastic, pliable kind of condition, because you can associate the fairways in compact forms or in less compact manners according to your idea of the field and your idea of the challenge that you're setting up the players. But what happens when you transport this game from a moist climate into dry climate? Golf's formal origins are credited to the coastal locality of St. Andrews in Scotland. It was there in Scotland where the game acquires the rules. Golf was played before that, but it was the Scots that decided to formalize this game. Since the game of golf had developed almost entirely on coastal links, until Linkland, up to until 1880s, we're told, it is not surprising that on many of the inland courses, at least some of the characteristics of those links were transported to inland sites. Some of the iconography of golf comes from the original setting of golf. For example, the use of sand. Of late development, the landscape course, the notion of the course as a garden with fully mature trees, and the notion of the fairway as a kind of corridor, visual corridor, is a later development of golf, which becomes very popular and nowadays probably is the dominating figure. But this is also to do with a narrative about a place of origin and dissemination of the game and encounter between this game that requires that play so closely with the ground and with natural formations, that encounter with places which are far removed from the original kind of conditions. What happens then when you remove golf into the desert? And this is in the Atacama Desert, northern Chile. You can probably just about see the field is here, and these are the different fairways. And they're just traced on the ground as geoglyphs. All that is left of that original landscape is a system of demarcations on the ground. There is no spatial differentiation. There is no greenery, obviously. There is nothing else accompanying the game other than a system of demarcations, as we see it in here as well. Um, topography and geometric demarcations are all that is left from the landscape course. We must remember, however, that visual progression was accrued over time, a gradual displacement from the bleakness of the St. Andrew's links into the dense body of the park. So here we have a dramatic case of adaptation because golf involves some kind of sense of ecology of the site. But there is also the other side to it, which is this pliability of the course itself, which is so adaptable that you can conceive of it as a compact form, as in this island course here, or as a complex arrangement, as you can see within the suburban development inland. Another form of adaptation is more mechanical, probably is to do with the notion of disaggregating the golf practicing range of this kind, where you simply take some of the moves of the game and you restructure those in relation to a field which is forever inaccessible to a player. So you can test your prowess playing up against the void. We find within the city, of course, the stacking up of fields as a form of adaptation. We know the case of downtown athletic club, which was so intensely commented by Kurhas, but there are many other examples of the same, where as a form of adapting the kind of sport activity to a city, the only way you can do it is through stacking up one on top of the other within the framework of a building, a high rise. And of course, this is also something that Le Corbusier and his generation saw very clearly in steamboats, where the activity, the ludic activity, was somehow taking place over the decks, crowning this kind of stacked up structure of the boat. And this is, in Villeradies, the notion of the roof terrace as a beach draws from the notion of the boat deck as a place of ludic activity. The idea was to furnish the rooftops of the apartment blocks with sand and water, and such as to have people behaving there as if they were by the sea. This kind of displacement and adaptation is something which is very interesting to look at in terms of the inscription of play arenas within the city, as we find in this attempt of Le Corbusier for setting up a tennis court on top of the Central Soyuz in Moscow. Or we find these children playing on a rooftop in a village in India. But the last point I want to make, and with this we will finish, is that there is another type of adaptation that goes on, which I think it's very, very important to visualize it, because it is much more widespread, and it's not so much in the hands of the architects to do it, but somehow it's something that grows from the grassroots. And it's to do with this type of geometric compromise, such as geometrically incorrect fields, that encounter the complexities of awkward sites, so that the issue here is neither compositional nor aesthetic, but is performative. People need to play, they want to have a playground, and they have to find a way of inscribing that within sites that do not give you the size or the geometry of the playground. What they do is simply to inscribe the playground and quite often to compromise the geometry or the size or both in order to achieve it. But what is interesting is that in these peripheral areas of cities in Brazil or Chile or Argentina or many other places, you find something like what we describe for the bullring, in terms of the idea of making the playing field more into a square, into a place which is not part of a sea of greenery, but which is a distinctive kind of social focus of a community. It's surrounded by houses, just like squares were surrounded by houses. So in a way, we come back full circle to find something like what we saw at the beginning. It is interesting to see how certain rules of orientation or scale or wherever are subverted in order to adjust the field to the site. And the game that comes out of it is not perfect. Of course, it does not conform to the rules, but still it can be played, and that's the important thing. And these are some extraordinary examples. But football pitches that reach a degree of geometric compromise that one would imagine would be completely out of question. So, to summarize then, if inquiry is about the notion of the playground and the place that the ludic space occupies within the city, we find that there is a movement which is the functionalist movement in a way that assigns the playground a zone, which is to do with a zone for recreation as distinct from an area for circulation, for example, or the commercial area or some other urban function. But there's also this very, very old tradition, which is an older tradition of play taking place in the middle of the city, and therefore leaving no traces behind, having no purpose-made playgrounds, just using the available kind of resources of the city and conjuring up, in a sense, the playground in the middle of the city. We saw how you could build up the fields, but how somehow you couldn't tamper with the definition of the field, but you can decide the contextualizing of the field, as here, for example, in this mining village, or here into the middle of a very dense formation. You can assign the field a different role depending on where you place it. What is the position of centrality that you assign the field in relation to the city? And we saw also how there was this old tradition of the street as a ludic space and of the ludic as a kind of interruption of the everyday occurrence of the city and the creation of this extraordinary event which somehow transfigurates the space of everyday life, as opposed to the notion of the arena as a space which is purpose-made and tailored to just one activity. We know how Aldo van Eyck tried to recolonize Amsterdam with, some people say 700, some other people say 900 playgrounds. And we did once, a student of mine did a survey in Rio de Janeiro of football pitches, many of them incorrect and irregular, found around the city, and there were around 400 such places distributed around it. So the urban presence of it is quite considerable. And the question I pose is just what to do with it, how to devolve the ludic space, that central kind of function and central expression in the city, how to bring it back with the experience of everyday life at every level in the city. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. I very much enjoyed that. You talk about sort of play as distinct or maybe mirroring real life. But I wonder if that isn't as very much a function of sort of modern society, that in reality, in sort of more traditional human experience, play is something that sort of continuously, spontaneously erupts from real life, in the middle of real life. And that whether or not there's a possibility of designing for that kind of spontaneous eruption of play, rather than just the formalized forms that that we spoke about.
That's perhaps is stronger, the impulse to create something spontaneous. Yeah, it might be that this one way of looking at it is that this is an episode and it's a historical episode. What is interesting is that the program of play, both in terms of the program of sports arenas and the program of children playground, becomes such a strong kind of issue during the modern period. But I can see how the children playground is a kind of contradiction in terms. It's trying to fix up something and to give shape to something that somehow is unshapable. And maybe the play instinct is much stronger when it's running up against the transformation of routine that when it finds its space into purpose-made place. And many people say that sport, that the model of sport, though it's still very popular, of course, in the world, but it's being superseded now by X games and other practices which are much more to do with someone lonely fighting up against the strength of the wind or some powerful natural condition somewhere, much less to do with the notion of spectacle, much less to do with the notion of prescribed rules, much less to do with the notion of teams and all that. So maybe this is an episode. Maybe one is charting a sort of an event or a certain narrative about things that happened to cities and landscapes over a certain period of time, rather than looking at a phenomenon that is developing along the same time now. I don't know, but I think it is interesting to notice how people like Constant, the situationists, bring to a closure, in a way, the issue about sports and the issue about the playground, saying that everything is now a playground, but everything is purpose-made also in that direction. It's kind of a paradox.